warm welcome to Austria and to the Red Bull Ring for the latest rounds of the Eurocup Formula Renault 2-litre Championship. We are about to commence the first race of their weekend, one of just two for the Austrian rounds. It's a 25-minute race plus the extra lap, so we don't run to lap distance as such. But these cars have been to quite a number of places already. It's a good season that the Eurocup Formula Renault have for 2016. Visits already to Motorland Aragon in Spain, and a one-off event at Monaco to support the Monaco Grand Prix just a few weekends ago. Three races at Monza happened at the start of this month, so a quick turnaround to head to Austria and the picturesque surroundings of Spielberg and the Styrian Mountains. We're in the middle of a valley here where you can peer across to mountainous areas. Fabulous place to go racing, and I think this track will really serve the Formula Renaults brilliantly well. My name's Johnny Palmer. I'm joined by the editor of dailysportscar.com, Graham Goodwin. And I know, Graham, this is a rare chance for you to experience some slightly shorter cut and thrust racing, but this is potentially where we're going to see the stars of prototype racing in 5-6 years' time.
Or indeed single-seater racing. And the Renault Sport product, of course, has been a staircase of talent. And this is, what, the 12th year of the Renault, the Formula Renault 2-litre Eurocup, and the roll of honour is pretty spectacular. Kamui Kobayashi, the winner in the first year, 2005, of course, now a Toyota factory driver in LMP1, and with Formula One career on his CV as well. Felipe Albuquerque, a not dissimilar career path, the 2006 winner. Brendan Hartley, current world champion in the FI World Endurance Championship, the third year's winner. And Valtteri Bottas, another Formula One talent there, the 2008 winner in this championship. So it's these young men on the grid will be looking to emulate some of those successes in the years to come.
It's away from Harrison Scott, who comes from Chelmsford in Essex. He's done quite a bit of single-seater racing in his short career. He's 20 years old, but having done some British Formula 3 racing this year, actually, at Silverstone, and also been in the MSA Formula back in the UK as well, but spreading his wings into Europe. One of many cars run by AVF, by Adrian Vaez, Spanish team. They have a Portuguese in their ranks, and late to the party here, Max De Forni, who won one of the opening rounds at Motorland earlier on this year. Young Belgian driver.
Second in the order at the moment.
So he's working his way now to the grid. One of three R-Ace GP cars. R-Ace GP used to be known as the Art Junior Team, and prior to that, R-Ace GP. So they've reverted back to their classic name, and they have three cars here this weekend. One for son of Jonathan, Will Palmer, and brother of Julian, of course, who's currently in Formula One, and Julian Falquero, who is a young Frenchman who has been relatively late to single-seater racing, done some karting at 16 years old. That was the case for the first couple of years of his career, and now finds himself in Eurocup Formula Renault. Pretty much all of these drivers, by the way, are doing double duty this year, not only the Eurocup Formula Renault, but also Formula Renault Northern European Championship, because the championships are actually designed to dovetail within each other, and you can do both together in parallel, and that's exactly what all these drivers are doing, it's my understanding. So they've had a busy year already. But Lando Norris, we've not talked about Lando yet, from Bristol in the UK, and he's had a plenty of single-seater action. Basically, if there's a single-seater race happening somewhere in the world, Lando will try and get himself on the grid, and he's very, very quick as well. MSA Formula champion from 2015, and took pole position in what was a red flag session earlier on today. There's only about 90 seconds of it to go, but Lando had also already got that crucial lap in.
Double champion, Toyota Racing Series champion, I think, last year as well.
Quite right,
so,
yes.
You know, busy through the winter, young Lando Norris, and a star of right now at this level, I'm sure a star of the future elsewhere onwards and upwards.
There is Will Palmer, as I say, comes from a great stock, you could say. The family is still based in Horsham in West Sussex, and Jonathan Palmer, chief exec at Brands Hatch and also Motorsport Vision, so has five racing venues to look after in England.
And last year's McLaren Autosport young driver, was he not, Will Palmer?
That's right. Yeah, and obviously brother doing very well in the upper echelons of single-seater racing. That is no doubt the target. Will Palmer having a great season last year in 15. This is Hugo de Sadelier, who is Swiss and one of a number of Tech One Racing prepared cars. You can tell the Tech One cars with their bright orange and black livery. Very striking. But the grid, in the process of being cleared, the three-minute board is about to be displayed. These cars, all identical by the way, but run by several different teams. Down to the grid though.
Lando Norris, a strong qualifying performance, pole position from race one at Red Wing. How does it feel?
I mean, obviously happy with the result. Couldn't have been any better. So good position for the first race. It got a bit tricky because of the wind was changing quite a bit in the middle. But yeah, I managed to get in a good position and put a couple of fast laps in. And take pole, which is ideal.
Lando, you're leading the championship. You have your teammate Daruvala next to you on the grid. How do you approach the race?
Well, main thing is not to crash, obviously. I think the main thing is to get a good first lap, obviously stay in front if possible. And if I can maybe break away within the first few laps, I can try and break the toe and get a bit of a gap. But apart from that, I'm still sure it's going to be quite difficult. But the pace is good, so I'm confident I can possibly break a gap to second place, but we'll have to wait and see.
Thank you very much, Lando. Have a good one.
Actually, Lando's sixth pole of the season within the confines of Formula Renault, by the way. He's had three in NEC, and that's his third in Eurocup Formula Renault 2-litre for this year. But Jahan Daruvala was mentioned there, starting alongside him, both Josef Kaufmann Racing cars. Jahan Daruvala is one of the Force India junior drivers, so he's been brought under the wing of Vijay Mallya, and Jahan Daruvala, a real talent from India.
Talking actually over a bit of lunch earlier to Kiran Chandok, who was singing the praises of that young man, and of course keeping an eye on his young countryman.
Absolutely.
About to get underway then, Johnny.
So this is a 25-minute race plus the extra lap. It will be a standing start, and therefore I think the only category that will do that this weekend, with plenty of Renault Sport Trophy racing to look forward to later on this weekend. There are two solo drive races and then the Enduro later today as well. But the final countdown board about to be displayed. A brave cameraman stood between the two lines of cars there as well. I assume they will stay there whilst the cars are released. And Josef Kaufmann Racing therefore best placed for a 1-2 if they can keep their cars out front. Max De Forni though will be looking to upset that result. The young Belgian from RACE GP, Harrison Scott, the top Brit, run by AVF by Adrian Vies. And then Ferdinand Habsburg, who is local. He comes from Salzburg, but we are blessed to be in the company of royalty this weekend. Ferdinand Habsburg is actually the great-grandson of Charles I of Austria.
The Habsburg Empire.
Indeed.
Yep. Indeed.
So directly in line to the throne, if you like. And he's the only Austrian in the field running at his local circuit. So will local knowledge come into play, I wonder? Here's confirmation of the grid then. Qualifying took place earlier on today. There's a separate qualifying session tomorrow morning for race two of the weekend. Lando Norris, though, starts alongside Jahan Daruvala to make it a Josef Kaufmann front row. Max De Forni, Harrison Scott, Habsburg and Dorian Boccalacci. Watch him go from sixth position. Starting from seventh, Will Palmer alongside Hugo de Sadelier. Alex Corny, the first of the Russians, alongside Julian Falquero. And then it is James Allen and Bruno Baptista, Australian and Brazilian respectively. Enrique Chaves from Portugal starts from 13th position alongside Frenchman Gabriel Albri. Then it's Sasha Fernandez, Robert Schwarzman, Vasily Romanov, Finlay Hutchison run out of the Mark Burdett Motorsport awning. Mark just with one car here this weekend. And Alessandro Parrulla is an Italian driver run by Techno Race, which is very much a family outfit. His uncle, Antonio, effectively funds that team. And Alessandro Parrulla here, as a pure enthusiast, I would say. I mean, you've got your Fortex, you've got your RACE GP outfits and Josef Kaufmann Racing, but it's great to see not quite a car brought on a small trailer. They've got a big articulated lorry, but it is just the one car and all family funded.
purveyors of fast Renault single-seaters and fine Italian coffee in the paddock.
That's right. That team. Yes, I was lucky enough to be asked in for an espresso, which was the best coffee I tasted all weekend, frankly. But Austria does other things very, very well, including scenery, as you can tell from some of these shots on this formation lap. So, Lando Norris clearly starting as the favourite for this weekend. He's had a couple of victories in the Northern European Cup this season, two of them in fact. And Johan de Ruvela, the last car to win in that championship. But he's also been winning in Eurocup as well, which travels a bit further afield, not strictly a regionalised championship, although still, of course, regionalised within Europe.
Interesting times for the Renault Sport product as the cars come and make up the grid, with the advance again to Formula One. I don't know about you, Johnny, I feel that they're going to be looking at where the future lies for various of their current and future products. And this championship, I feel, is going to be a very important one on that ladder to come.
Yep, certainly a chance to see some stars of the future here and some very talented guys and girls. It is all males on this current grid, but we have had females take part in the championship earlier on this year, including at Motorland Aragon. 19 cars then about to get underway for this 25-minute race, plus the extra lap. Lando Norris sort of pointed towards the apex of the first corner. The green flag is waved at the back of the field then, and who will get the best of the starts of these Josef Kaufmann Racing cars? Lando Norris or Johan de Ruvela? It'll be five red lights that are extinguished now, and the latest round of the championship gets underway at Red Bull Ring as they power their way up towards the first corner. Max De Forni getting a good start. Can he slot his way into third position around the outside of Harrison Scott? Yes, he can. So De Forni makes his way up to third position. Harrison Scott running down in fourth, but a fantastic getaway by Lando Norris up the hill. He's away from Johan de Ruvela, who's now under pressure from Max De Forni.
Got the power down beautifully well and just left the rest behind to squabble over the minor places, and that's the way it goes through to turn three. And well, that's a one tight pack of Renaults with one moving away.
Yeah, well, Lando Norris is a car off on the grass there. He said the plan was to try and get the foot down as quickly as possible. That's exactly what he's managed to do. And down into Rauch corner for the first time. Challenge still on for second position as Max De Forni gets a good exit out of turn number three. Side by side though for second and third here, and de Ruvela having to seesaw at the wheel to hang on to second place. He's just about managed it, but the Belgian is all over his rear wing, and the Belgian has the inside line, has to back out of that though into Wörth corner. So Lando Norris leads the way. 1.7 seconds is the gap back to Johan de Ruvela, and Josef Kaufmann Racing on course at the moment for a 1-2, but de Ruvela having to stick his elbows out. He's got two cars now ganging up on him, and just De Forni goes through. De Forni right round the outside, and de Ruvela cannot match the pace of these cars around him. That's Habsburg, I think, into third position. So Ferdinand Habsburg, we wondered whether local knowledge would come into the equation. It certainly has. He's up to third position.
Beautiful move up the inside as the car ahead of him just got a little bit of trouble, outbraked himself there. Habsburg taking the outside line, taking it beautifully well, exactly the same line as the race leader did, as several of the cars go way, way, way wide.
Yeah,
Overambitious on the brakes there.
Johan de Ruvela was one of them, and I wonder whether possibly Dorian Balcalacci pointed skyward briefly with the front wheels way up in the air as he caught the sausage curb on the exit of turn number one. A little bit of a lock up there from Ferdinand Habsburg, as the gap is 2.6 seconds from Lando Norris back to Max De Forni in second position. This little lot will take some sorting out though as they go across the top here between turns two and three and head for Rauch corner on only this, the second lap. So 25 minutes plus the lap, remember, is the race distance for one of two races this weekend for Eurocup Formula Renault 2 litre. Two abreast in several places around the track. De Ruvela, I'm not sure whether this is a car setup issue or maybe getting the tyres up to temperature, but he is struggling here to match the pace of the cars around him. Currently running in fourth position with Ferdinand Habsburg up ahead, Max De Forni running second, and Lando Norris now with a 2.3 second gap. Can De Forni start to whittle that away?
That's because De Forni is now in clear air and beginning to make some inroads into the lead of Lando Norris. Lando Norris got away beautifully, but De Forni putting in a very quick lap at the moment, beginning to close down on the Briton ahead. but still well over 2 seconds. In fact, he's taken over half a second out of the leader on that lap, with the fastest lap of the race, a 129.979, the first man under 130.
Max De Forni has won a race this year. It's the opening encounter, in fact, at Motorland in April, but hasn't had a race win since then. Got a lot of work to do to try and get one in this opening race, as Jahan de Ruwele is side by side with Harrison Scott. And at the end of the first sector, Scott got the judgment, but he needs to go around the outside there and is forced off the track on the exit. Has that lost him further places? No. So he stays, Harrison Scott, in fifth position behind the Indian driver de Ruwele. But now ganging up on him is Will Palmer in that red and white machine. Down into Rauch corner they go then for this, the third time. There are two Tech 1 cars immediately behind the de Ruwele-Palmer battle, by the way. One of them is Hugo de Sadelier, the other one being Dorian Boccalacci. A little relatively quiet race for Boccalacci so far, as he tries to move on his teammate. That doesn't quite come off, though, into the first of the left-handers.
Side by side they were through the last two turns. But car getting away now. Forni, meanwhile, is continuing to close down on the leader. Under 2 seconds now, the gap. But those two getting away here.
Yeah, it's going to be between those two, you would think, for the race win. There is Lando Norris then. He is labelled as a rookie driver because this is his first season of Eurocup Formula Renault 2-litre and indeed Formula Renault Northern European Championship. But that kind of belies his ability, I would say. And if he sticks with this championship for a second year, then that rookie status will leave him. But it's two rookies being run by Josef Kaufmann Racing, the other one being Robert Schwarzman.
Takes another half a second now to the leader, De Forni. It's down to 1.7 seconds now, with another lap under 130. Not quite the pace that Lando Norris can match at the moment. He's still got a good advantage, but it's being whittled away, and there's nearly 20 minutes still to go in this race. Time enough for De Forni, if he continues this progress, to get back on the terms of the leader.
Gabriel Aubry trying to make some progress there. He is racing with Sacha Fenestraz, the Frenchman, and James Allen, the man from Perth in Australia, just behind in car number 18. So that's a scrap for 14th position.
It was James Allen, by the way, that had that grassy moment at the start of the race.
Yes, that will have certainly woken him up if he hadn't been alert enough already at the start of this quickfire race. You haven't got a lot of time to try and think through a strategy here. It's just a case of get your foot down as quick as possible and try and make up places. The two Tech 1 cars are still running nose to tail then, out of the unnamed right-hand kink, which follows Wörth corner, and now heading into Rint, which is the penultimate right-hander. Careful not to run wide on the exit there, where there are a number of yellow sausage curves ready to catch drivers out. Lando Norris over the line. 1.4 seconds is now the gap after four laps. Max De Forni closing in with another fastest lap of the race.
Absolutely. It was the fastest lap of the race just very briefly for Lando Norris, but that was improved by a further 2 tenths by De Forni. 1.5 seconds is now the gap, and that was, what, 2.3 just three laps ago.
So Norris, De Forni, Ferdinand Habsburg on course for his best finish of the year. Jahan de Ruwele running in fourth. Then it's Harrison Scott, Will Palmer, Hugo de Sadelier and Dorian Boccalacci in similarly coloured cars. The two Tech 1 machines then behind Will Palmer. Then there's a bit of a gap before we see the Ford Tech machine.
And neat and tidy stuff from this field, Johnny, despite the fact it's been wheel-to-wheel stuff from the off in this pack. 14 and a half seconds separate all 19 cars at the moment. So some really good close racing, as one of the cars goes wide there through just through the gravel and loses time and positions there.
Really good time again through the middle sector for Max De Forni, who is trying to close in on this man, as we see again the off-track moment, which may well have been one of the AVF cars. Enric Chaves then, the Portuguese driver, number 21, being pushed hard there by Romanov just behind.
Batista, I think, got through there.
Yeah, Bruno Batista making one place up. And there was a slow car coming out of the final corner there, which may well have been Will Palmer. Does Will Palmer cross the line where he should do? No, he doesn't. Tumbles down the order. And an issue, therefore, for Will, as the two Tech 1 cars are side by side now. So this is De Sadelier versus Boccalacci. And one of the cars has to go way, way wide and rejoin, hammers that yellow curb in the process. And the car behind is, I think, Valquero. What has happened to Will Palmer? Through in 10th position. And it might even be worse than that now if that it was a car issue. Yes, tumbling to 12th position now. So mechanical gremlins, I would think, for Will Palmer, as Deruvola has a job on his hands here with Harrison Scott closing in.
Further 0.2, meanwhile, bitten out of the lead of Lando Norris. De Forney now 1.1 seconds back, having taken, 2.5 tenths last time around.
Meanwhile, one of the other Tech One cars found the James Allen bit of grass there between turns 2 and 3, and immediately, having rejoined the track, started weaving to try and clean up the tyres as best as possible.
Beginning to get black and white flags for track limits warnings, not surprising. Some very, how can we put it, unique racing lines being taken by one or two of these young men.
16 minutes to go, plus a lap. So plenty of racing still to be done. And I had a feeling this circuit would generate some close action. It's been relatively clean stuff, but yes, there have been some one or two off-track moments as well. And front wheels pointing up in the air for a little while, having caught the curbs at turns 1 and turn 7 as well.
Will Palmer, by the way, came through in 13th position after that problem. But meanwhile, at the head of the order, the gap is now under a second. It was almost half a second taken out of Lando Norris's lead by De Forney last time around. 0.735 is the gap as they power round now through lap 7.
So, yeah, less than a second after a new fastest lap by De Forney. Deruvola is, if anything, holding Harrison Scott up a little bit now. It'll be interesting to see how quickly Harrison might be able to go in clean air. Dorian Boccalacci has worked his way through the chaos, and he's got ahead of his teammate as well, Hugo de Sadalia. And then it's Julian Falquero. But we're focusing on Will Palmer, I think, trying to make his way back up the order here. So Henri Chaves is just ahead of him. There is the Deruvola-Harrison-Scott battle. It's fourth and fifth positions, and Harrison trying to get close enough. You can slipstream in this category, but there is that element of the air across the car being disrupted by the machine in front, so you do go a little bit slower. But the opportunity to slipstream is down the main straight, up the hill to turn 2, and then down the other straight to turn 3. So let's see whether Harrison Scott can get close enough to be able to do that.
Meantime, the gap continues to come down, first to second, under half a second now, but De Forney gets a black and white warning flag. Reason unknown at the moment.
Yes. Track limits, I'm thinking.
Doesn't say so at the moment, but you'd have to guess that would be it.
But he's right with Lando Norris now. So Lando Norris, up to this point, may well have had everything his own way, but he is having to look into the mirrors here just to be wary about where Max De Forney is. They're not run out of the same stable, remember. So they are true rivals, and this is crucial for the championship as well. Lando Norris has a decent lead after the three Monza races, but it's the top two in the championship duking it out here in the latest round of the Eurocup Formula Renault 2 litre. Meanwhile, very, very busy Remus corner at the top of the hill, and over the rise they go underneath the bridge and down towards Rauch.
This is the back end of the field. This is the battle for 13th, 14th, 15th and 16th positions.
Yep, so Will Palmer is the second of those cars, and he's on a bit of a recovery drive now with James Allen, the back of that pack, which is the car that went wayward. And Will Palmer's hit more problems again, almost as if the car is cutting out on him at times. So it was slow there into the first of the left-handers. Back with the leaders though through the final corner. We're still 13 minutes on the clock. Lando Norris from Max De Forney. What's the gap at the line? It was 0.396 of a second. It's 0.358 of a second now. So it's coming down very slightly. And this might be a good opportunity for Max De Forney, heading through the first corner and climbing up the hill.
This is it's now all about how does Lando Norris respond to the pressure from behind. He's been trying to fend off the ever closer attention to Max De Forney. De Forney's done a brilliant job in closing down what was a massive gap at the start of the race. Looks up the inside now,
and he's gone for it and takes the race lead. Now what does Lando Norris do? Tucks back into line to presumably try and repay the favour down at Rauch corner. He is close enough, and this all of a sudden means he's got the slipstream now. Can only find the outside line though. So Lando Norris versus Max De Forney. The blue car on the inside of the corner is the Belgian, the Brit in the red and white car, and Lando Norris was shown to the outside line. Meanwhile, more black and white warning flags, this time to car number 21
Travis.
For disrespecting the track limits. So that's through the inside, there goes Lando Norris to retake the lead. So this is yin and yang stuff. We've had two lead changes now on this lap alone. Through Wirth corner they go, underneath the Wirth bridge now, and crest the rise into the approach for the final right-handers. Max de Forn into the outside, Lando Norris to the inside, but Norris is able to defend.
This, though, is allowing Habsburg to start to close in on these guys. He's not been inside 4 seconds from the very start of this race. Now about 3.5 seconds back from the lead pair, battling away. 11.5 minutes remain, plus that lap.
So Lando Norris, knowing full well he was overtaken at turn two on the previous lap, will he approach that corner any differently, I wonder? There is an element when you are being caught by a car behind you and they are taking advantage of your slipstream, an element of you being a sitting duck, I suppose, but it's about where you position the car at the top of the hill. And Lando Norris doesn't go defensive. Now, he allowed the door to be open last time around. Is this part of the plan as Max de Forn retakes the lead? But it does mean that Lando Norris can get the toe down this back straight, and to the outside line goes Lando Norris. Inside line for Max de Forn. We've been here before a lap ago. Lando Norris trying to be as late on the brakes as he dares, but now he can do the switch back perhaps. Can he go up the inside of Max de Forn? The exit though for the Belgian is good towards the double left-hander. Now we know that Lando Norris is quick into this corner. Is Max de Forn going to give him racing room? Yes, he is. And they'll exchange, but eventually. Yeah, it was a worrying stage there whether that gap was going to emerge or not, and de Forn given very little choice but to concede the race lead once more. So Lando Norris back in front, an almost identical lap to the previous one.
Fabulous stuff from these two, good clean stuff as well. Great performance from both drivers to this stage. Where there was the third place car, and the answer is under 2.5 seconds back now. Habsburg is going to be involved in this battle very soon indeed, and being caught as well by De Ruvela back in fourth position. He's under 4.5 seconds back now.
So Ferdinand Habsburg's best result was actually second at Monaco, but away from the Principality, his best result a seventh position. So set to do a lot better than that here at his home track. He's nearly with the top two, Lando Norris, from Max de Forn though, first and second. And there is Ferdinand Habsburg. I don't think de Forn is going to be close enough this time to take the lead. He's late on the brakes, but no, the gap kind of appeared by Lando Norris, but he realised that Max wasn't fully alongside him, so keeps the race lead. And this is also drawing in the cars in fourth and fifth positions, Johan de Ruvela and Harrison Scott, who have been more or less fully attached for the whole of this race, and they're still running fourth and fifth. We could have a scrap involving five cars for the lead of the race very shortly.
We could indeed at the moment. Lando Norris, yes, he's charging away, but I think he's also relying on Habsburg getting involved with de Forn here to take the pressure off from behind. And a very composed run there from Lando Norris over the last couple of laps. Young man, 16 years of age, could easily have lost his head, having lost that big lead from the lead of the race, but that just looked to be totally controlled.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. He has got a mature head on young shoulders, you could say, and he's doing so much racing currently. I think experience is really paying for Lando Norris. Max de Forn right behind him, then still Ferdinand Habsburg with some distance to find for the two cars up ahead. There's been an incident involving Ulrich Schabs and the 18 car of Will Palmer. That's to be investigated at the end of the race.
Another one involving 21 and 6 this time, 6 car being Batista, also under investigation. So it looks like Chavez has been a busy boy.
Dorian Boccalacci still showing good pace, by the way. He did the absolute best sector one time in the number 9 car, down in 8th position. But Boccalacci has done well, as there's another lead change there at the second corner. But Lando Norris this time gets good traction off the corner and might be able to get back in front even before they reach turn 3. Yes, he can. So Max de Forn, we know, is good onto the brakes into Remus corner, but they're heading for Rauch now, turn 3. And Lando Norris has the inside line, although de Forn is leaving his braking to the last possible moment. Outside inside touch perhaps from de Forn. Yes, he's almost got his front wheels level with the rears of Lando Norris. He'll need to go around the outside though of this left-hander. That's not going to be possible, as Lando Norris, not quite a block pass there for Norris, but he left his braking maybe a bit later than normal. It means the car tumbled into the corner a bit more than the previous lap, and that served as his defence. So Lando Norris and Max de Forn putting on a great show here. Which way is this one going to go? We sense that Norris has maybe just about got the edge on Max de Forn. He seems happy for de Forn to lead at certain parts of the lap. of course, at the end of the lap, it's always been Lando Norris in front. Ferdinand Habsburg is loitering with intent in third position. What's the gap like? 1.1 seconds. So Habsburg found time again on the two leaders. De Ruvela and Harrison Scott are still fourth and fifth. Sixth position is Hugo de Sadelier, and Dorian Boccalacci's gained a place since we last checked on him. Seventh position now for the Frenchman.
De Forney, for my money, it's certainly the more aggressive of the two here, and it's great to watch. But Lando Norris, what an old head on young shoulders this is. Very aware of what's going on around him. As you say, Johnny, perfectly content to actually follow for a corner or two. And very content that he's actually got the ability to get by again. No panic whatsoever apparent from the number two car. And we've seen the challenging number 33 ahead, what, four times so far?
Yes, but
and
it's
every
time been.
It's been three corners at maximum before we've seen Norris back through into the lead.
That's right, and it's always been in the areas of turns two and three, and nearly always Lando Norris has got back in front as they reach Wörth corner. This one, in fact, as they head through it. So Norris, De Forney, and then Ferdinand Habsburg gap back to the Johan de Ruvela Harrison Scott battle, and then another gap to Hugo de Sadelier and Dorian Boccalacci, who is having a disappointing race by his own standards, comes here to Red Bull Ring having not been out of the top four in the last six races, but is down in seventh position at the moment. Over the line they go with a bit more than 5 minutes to go. De Forney trying to get as close as he can to Lando Norris, not going to be close enough to challenge for the lead of the race into turn one. Can he utilise that slipstream up the hill to two?
And if this is what we've got to look forward to in the years to come from the higher echelons of professional rankings, no complaints from me. Two young guys here driving well within themselves, quickly, aggressively. That's De Forney trying to look up the inside there, bit of a lock-up, and that allowed Lando Norris through and clear. Has that allowed Habsburg to close up a little again? It has.
Also great to have the Renault Sports Series as part of the European Le Mans Series package for the year. That will remain the case for the rest of their year, so more races to come at Paul Ricard, Spa-Francorchamps, and then Estoril in Portugal to end the season. And this is a great stage for the young guys to be performing on, not only no doubt for their Formula One aspirations, but also perhaps an alternative route into motorsport. There are plenty of prototype team managers here that might catch a bit of the odd Eurocup Formula Renault race and say, oh, he might be worth a go, as there's a moment there for Finlay Hutchinson, who's being run at the Mark Burdett Motorsport stable this weekend, and the man to benefit was Alessandro Parrulo up at turn two. 3 minutes and 50 seconds plus the lap to go then, and into turn number one goes Lando Norris with Max De Forney in second position. Ferdinand Habsburg has sort of hit a sticking point here, can't get any closer than about a second to the two cars in front. And it's a Josef Kaufmann Racing versus RHGP battle, by the way, as the blue car of Max De Forney with matching helmet heads into turn number two, not close enough to challenge this time around. Meanwhile, Harrison Scott, who has threatened Johan de Ruvela for most of this race, again can't really get much closer than about 0.4 of a second, and de Ruvela is not buckling under the pressure of Harrison Scott. There's the car of Alessandro Parrulo, so that's the machine that we saw benefit from the spin of number 44. And there was obviously an issue towards the end of that lap then, as the car went straight on turn number one, all four tyres still inflated, it would appear. Whether that was a vibration, a suspension issue, or maybe engine related, but the Parrulo car has come to a halt, and sadly for Alessandro, his first race will result in a non-finish underneath the Wörth bridge. For the 15th time comes Lando Norris then. Max De Forney no more than a car length between he and the race leader. The gap at the start of this lap was 0.320 of a second. Has it come down? No, it's gone up very slightly. It's 0.34, but very small margins. So we've got two cars leading Habsburg a little bit on his own, then a further duo, de Ruvela and Scott, in fourth and fifth positions. Then a big margin back to Hugo de Sadelier, but he seems pretty happy to run in sixth position there.
better run for the second place car through turn one and up the hill. There's not going to be room to have a look at the inside there, though. Lando Norris covers that very well indeed. But what about the drag race now? Is there room? He's going to take a look.
Showing good speed out of turn number two. He's certainly going to get an overlap, but the problem is for Max DeForney, he'll only have the outside line, and neither driver has been able to make that work. A lock-up there for Lando Norris on the inside, just about being given racing room, and Max DeForney very close to dipping a couple of wheels into the gravel trap there on the exit. Can he hold the inside line coming out of Rauch corner? Yes, he can. So this is new territory now. We haven't had Max DeForney in the lead of the race at this point of the circuit. Lando Norris has been happy to allow him through at certain points, knowing full well he should get the lead back again by the end of the lap, but this time it'll be the first lap led by Max DeForney.
That was very, very gutsy stuff from Max DeForney. Lando Norris, I thought, had done enough there, but somehow DeForney found a way through where there seemed to be no room whatsoever.
So through the final corner they go, and has Max DeForney timed this to perfection? They'll have two more laps from this point. Over the line they go then, a car length between Max DeForney of RHGP and the Josef Kaufmann Racing car of Lando Norris. Remember, DeForney's won one race so far this year. Lando Norris has three to his name, two in Spain, one in Italy. Which way will this latest round at Red Bull Ring go? And will Ferdinand Habsburg have a say on where the top two finish as well? Ooh, that is suspension failure.
That's trouble.
Yeah, I thought it was a tyre, but the tyre's still inflated. Suspension failure, so three wheels steering on that machine. Difficult to identify.
It's Will Palmer.
Was it? So, more difficulties for the young man as we concentrate again on the lead of the race, but also fourth position, because Harrison Scott has got ahead of Johan de Ruvela. That hadn't happened at the line, but in the first couple of corners, Harrison Scott presumably, well, it could have happened at turn one, it could have happened at turn two, as Lando Norris is on the fight back here, up the inside. He's, two wheels on the grass, but he managed to get that move done on the absolute limit. Max DeForney, I think, saw him coming, and here comes Fernando Habsburg to make it three for the lead. Habsburg for the win, perhaps. We'll see what happens. He is the Austrian, remember, from Salzburg. Third position for Ferdinand Habsburg. Best result of the year, second place. Down towards the right-hander goes this lead battle. As trying to stab a move at the inside, there goes Max DeForney. He can't find a way through. There'll be one more lap as here comes Habsburg. So running side by side with Max DeForney, and this might actually bring a favour to Lando Norris, because all of a sudden Habsburg is getting involved. How late on the brakes can Ferdinand be? Will there be contact at turn number one? That's a clean move round the outside at Max DeForney. Goes Ferdinand Habsburg, knows this place, you would guess, like the back of his hand, and into second position goes Ferdinand Habsburg, and this is giving Lando Norris a bit of a break.
Well, remember when I said that Lando Norris looked the more contained and the less aggressive? Scratch that, but that was great stuff there from Lando Norris. Great stuff as well from Habsburg. And here again comes DeForney up the inside this time of Habsburg. Can he make it there? Can he make it stick? I think he can.
A massive lock-up, though, from Ferdinand Habsburg, trying to get the car stopped. That front right wheel will be like a 50 pence piece now. He'll have to endure the vibration only for one more lap, as Max DeForney does indeed get into second position. So Norris leads, DeForney in second. We've been here before, but after much, much squabbling. And Ferdinand Habsburg is in third position. Harrison Scott well and truly away now in fourth position, and he might trouble the podium, you know, with a few corners to go. The gap is growing between Scott and de Ruvela, now falling to fifth position. And de Ruvela, well, he's got a couple of Tech 1 cars not very far away, but he might just be okay for fifth position. So the battle is on for third place here. Here comes Harrison Scott, only got a couple of more corners to go. A real good drive, though, from Lando Norris, and it was a last-ditch effort, really, to take the lead back again from Max DeForney. He's going to work his way across towards the team to celebrate with them, with Josef Kaufmann Racing. It's another win in the 2016 Eurocup Formula Renault 2-litre, though, for Lando Norris. Win number four for the Bristolian, ahead of Max DeForney. We had those cars first and second for a long time, but that race really came to a head towards the end, Graham.
That was a great single-seater race. Lando Norris hugely impressed with that young man. DeForney made a real race of that. That made the event, made the race. But impressive stuff from Lando Norris. When the chips were down, he had to pull that last 2% out, and boy did he do it. Really aggressive move, perfectly fair, very controlled indeed. Great win for Lando Norris. That is the kind of win, Johnny, that defines a season.
Into Pirelli corner. on the limit. I mean, smoke coming from all four tyres, and then he actually dipped two of those wheels onto the grass as well, but somehow found the grip, avoided the contact crucially with Max DeForney. And Max maybe a little disappointed with that, having held the lead for, he was across the line as the leader for one lap, but Lando Norris got it back again, and he was not to be denied. That will further extend, therefore, his championship lead over Max DeForney. And actually, the two of them will stretch out their legs quite a bit from Dorian Boccalacci, who comes across the line in the end in 10th. So Dorian Boccalacci really struggled in that race for whatever reason. Not quite his worst result of the year, because he finished 11th in Spain. But as I say, never been out of the top four for the last six races. So Dorian Boccalacci with some pace to find, you could argue, overnight at Tech One Racing. Flags being waved, though, by the marshals, who I'm sure enjoyed that race just as much as we did. And Lando Norris is about to be received by the organisers of Eurocup Formula Renault. Here is the, well, several moments that we saw with Max DeForney getting in front of Lando Norris, and then Lando Norris would repay the favour. Is this the squirrely moment? No, not quite. Into Pirelli corner, he did take the lead, and DeForney tried every which way, to the right, to the left. At certain points he was allowed to head through. And it really did interest me at Remus at times. Lando Norris clearly left the door wide open, said, after you, Max, because I'll do you on the next corner.
Well, for me, that's the kind of race, as we see the overall result there with Lando Norris confirmed as the race winner, 0.89 of a second ahead of Max DeForney. Show that race to young drivers coming into the sport, because that was proper single-seater racing. No contact, no red flags, nothing of the sort, just great racing. That was a pleasure to watch.
Ferdinand Habsburg, the local boy from Salzburg, finishing in third position. Harrison Scott from the UK, so two Brits in the top four, finishing fourth ahead of Johan Deruvela. That was a race-long battle as well for Harrison Scott to finally wrestle fourth place away from the Force India junior driver, Johan Deruvela. And Hugo de Sadalier finishing in sixth position ahead of Julio Falquero, the second of the rookies. So, of course, let us not forget Lando Norris is labelled a rookie driver, but he's had several overall wins so far this year as well. Falquero finishes second place rookie ahead of Alexis Corneve in the number 17 car. And then it was Bruno Battista and Dorian Boccalacci, as I say, in 10th.
I'll correct myself, by the way. It was Finlay Hutchison that had this suspension failure at the end. I was getting my British drivers mixed up, so apologies for that. But one of three non-finishers, I'm afraid. Finlay Hutchison, Pirillo and Will Palmer all suffering the slings and arrows of outrageous racing fortune.
Meanwhile, though, there'll be much chatter down in the driver's enclosure there, having seen the three cars come into Parc Fermé, and almost in Formula One fashion, they will splay out first, second and third. A big grin, though, I'm sure, on Lando Norris's face. Let's find out, catch up with Lando after a frenetic race.
Lando Norris, fourth win of the season, but what about always Max DeForney? Tell us how it was behind the wheel.
Well, it was a very difficult race from an overall perspective. I mean, my start was very good. The first lap was really good. I think I had almost a 2 second gap. So everything was going very well at that point. And yeah, I thought it was pretty fast. But lap by lap, Max started to catch me. And I'm not sure how from the end, like 8 laps from the end or something, he was pretty close. So I started to struggle quite a bit with my tyres. Yeah, I thought I could hold him off for a bit, but he was quite a bit fast, so we tacked quite a bit. It was very close. There was a lot of overtakes. It was a hard race, and I'm thankful for the result.
How important was it for you, Lando, to keep Max behind you in the championship?
Obviously having more points than him is great. It wasn't a major... Well, it wasn't too bad if I finished behind him. I want to win, and I did it.
Thank you very much. Congratulations, Lando.
So that win added to the Monza win and two in Spain at Motorland Aragon means that the championship battle is extended to, well, 144 points now for Lando Norris, and therefore the gap back is 29.5 points to Max Stefani for RHGP. Dorian Boccalacci losing points on the two cars ahead of him, though. 101 points now for the Frenchman. Harrison Scott will have gained a little bit, up to 96 points, and fourth place for the AVF run car. Bruno Baptista, 11th place in the points, with 20 to his name ahead of Gabriel Albri, Henri Chaves and Hugo de Sadalier for Tech One Racing. But action-packed, as I'm sure you can appreciate, thoroughly enjoyable to call that race. And we have more action to come, of course, from the Eurocup Formula Renault 2-litre tomorrow here at Red Bull Ring. There's another qualifying session tomorrow morning to set the grid for race two. And it will be a two-race format for the rest of the year. Here's a replay of the start, though. Lando Norris getting the jump. And actually, Max Stefani didn't get away too well. Remember, he was starting from the second row. He slotted into third position in the end, but almost Harrison Scott was able to overtake him into turn number one. And then we were treated to just a fantastic battle between Lando Norris and Max Stefani, switching places several times on each lap. And this was the time when Lando Norris would leave the door open at Remus Corner, allow Max Stefani through for that top section between turns two and three, and then often take the lead back again at Pirelli Corner, this left-hander, which then leads to another left. And that meant that there Lando Norris was fully able to firm up that position once again as race leader. But Max Stefani thought about things. Clearly he worked out exactly where he was quicker and was able to pull off a move around the outside at Rauch Corner. Lando Norris on the limit did so well not to run into the side of Max Stefani, and Stefani kept there to Lando's left and was able finally to take the race lead proper into Pirelli Corner and hold it to the line. But this was the real squirrely moment for Lando Norris. There was smoke from the rears, there were two wheels on the grass there, and somehow he found the grip on the outs and the inside of Pirelli Corner to hang on. And they powered their way out of the final corner, Ferdinand Habsburg troubling Max Stefani as well. And this was the moment when the Austrian and great-grandson of Charles I of Austria, the Habsburg dynasty, worked his way around the outside there of turn number one. Big lock-up, though, at Remus Corner, and that was where Max Stefani was able to get back in front of Habsburg across the top section of the circuit. Blue car from RHGP into second place. Habsburg, in the end, held on for a podium, and this was all drawing Harrison Scott in. You can see in the distance there in the AVF car, he'd wriggled free of Johan de Ruvelo. And Harrison Scott was able to get reasonably close to Ferdinand Habsburg for third position. Lando Norris, though, weaving from left to right. And I think he really did enjoy that win. He had to well and truly work for it. He's had easier wins this year, but now has four to his name.
I think they'll have both enjoyed that race. We could see a bit of friendly waving after the flag, but fair to say that Lando Norris ultimately would have enjoyed it the more. And we're going to have... So Olivier Parnas, I think, is going to be presenting trophies here, which is great to see. A Grand Prix winner, of course.
And Fabian Barthez
on the
right.
And Fabian Barthez. So a World Cup winner and a Grand Prix winner. There's worse people to present cups, aren't there?
I think there are.
And what to remember.
These guys will be among the happiest in the European Le Mans Series paddock as well, having taken a double pole for tomorrow's four-hour race of Red Bull Ring. But let's turn our attention back to Eurocup Formula Renault 2-litre with Ferdinand Habsburg about to be welcomed onto the podium in third position. He works his way down the steps. This is the podium used by Formula One, of course, only a couple of weekends ago. And could we be seeing the Formula One stars of the future? Max Stefani to the far side. First of all, a big handshake with Ferdinand Habsburg and a handshake with Olivier Panis as well. But a real good, mature drive there by Lando Norris. Handshakes for all three drivers, which is good to see. And we'll hear the national anthem, I'm sure, of the winning driver very, very shortly. Big, deep breath there from Lando Norris. Hard work done for today. And another race to look forward to tomorrow, with a lot of racing still to take place. Here is the national anthem, though, as the flags rise from behind the podium. And Olivier Panis and Fabian Barthez ready to give the trophies out in just a moment.
These days you've just got to check you've got the right flag for the UK.
Here is the national anthem of the winning driver. So congratulations to Lando Norris, Max Tifone finishing in second position, and third place to Ferdinand Habsburg. And there will be trophies to be presented, along with no doubt victory garland for Lando Norris by Olivier Panis and by Fabien Barthez. Here is the third place trophy. Ferdinand Habsburg, I'm sure, with a lot of local support. Family will be here as well. And very, very happy with not quite his best result of the year. As I say, finished second at Monaco earlier on in the year, in back end of May, which was one of many support races for the Formula 1 Grand Prix in Monte Carlo. Treacherous race that, with a lot of rain across the weekend. Max Tifone getting a second place finish at the first place trophy, with the BRM sponsorship that all these cars have, and the trophy supports that as well, going to Lando Norris. There'll be photographs as well, no doubt, in a moment, with all three drivers gathering together on the top step. But as I say, these cars, this category, will support the European Le Mans Series throughout the rest of the year. So towards the end of August, in a little over a month's time, there are races at Paul Ricard and Le Castellet. A month later, a visit to Belgium, to Spa, and it's fair to say Max Tifone, a bit of a local specialist around that place. And then the season ends at Autodromo, the Estoril in Portugal, as the champagne flies for the first time this weekend. And congratulations to Lando Norris, who suitably doused there by both Max and Ferdinand. As the cars will disappear back into the paddock, the various professional teams will strip the cars down to a certain extent, make sure that the brakes are ready for another 25-minute race. And we look forward to more Eurocup Formula Renault 2-litre action tomorrow for the next round of the 2016 season. From Graham Goodwin and myself, Johnny Palmer, it's goodbye for now.